I just asked Jeffrey Smith to join us today. I couldn't resist the opportunity to have his input. So he agreed, and we are very grateful to get his additional input. He will be giving his full lecture on, tomorrow at 2 o'clock. So I will introduce him at that point in great detail. But he has been, in my opinion, the leading advisor and thought leader on GMOs that we have been listening to for several years. So we're very grateful to him for joining us. Before we continue, Dr. Cousens, could you just tell everyone the events of what you're going to be doing in the morning and then tomorrow night? We'll just tell everyone what you'll be doing.
Yeah, so our plan tomorrow is that I'll be teaching the yoga and also breathing, which is really, really important. And then we're going to have what we call Shaktipat meditation, or yoga tradition. And then tomorrow evening at 4:45, with candle lighting at 5 of 5, we'll be having a shamanic Shabbat, which will include the meditation. It's not going to have much food, right? But we'll have a live food challah, and you know what we need to make it happen. So it will be in the same room. I'm not sure where that room is.
What's the name of the room? Pindar. Pindar. P-I-N-D-A-R. The Pindar room. So if you pass the front desk and go down the first hallway to all the way at the end, the Pindar room.
So the yoga and meditation will start at 7 a.m. tomorrow morning. And be there bright and shiny. And then the Shamanic Shabbat. Both will have meditations and be a really kind of a deeper understanding of both yoga and meditation and Shabbat. Okay? So, see you there.
Okay.
4:45 in the afternoon for Shabbat, 7 a.m. to about 9:15. In the morning tomorrow for yoga meditation.
Okay. And then, Ocean, could you just let everyone know, I'm sure you've worked for many years on this book. It's about to be released. When is it being released? How do people get it?
31-Day Food Revolution, Heal Your Body, Feel Great, and Transform Your World, comes out on Tuesday. So this is my first big book. And there have been over 10,000 pre-orders, I know, and probably more, and we're going to be on the Today Show on Tuesday, and I think I can say that now. They've taped it, so it's pretty likely. And a lot of other big media coming up this week. So this is actually the first day of my book launch tour. I'll be traveling throughout the Northeast for the next 8 days, trying to really make this big push for Pub Week and get on bestseller lists, and then that kind of builds its own momentum, because we want to get the food revolution out as widely as possible. We sold out of books today within about 5 minutes after my talk wrapped up. But if you didn't get one, you can get one at a local bookstore. You can also get one online, of course. So you can go to 31dayfoodrevolution.com, our website, and get it from there. And I'm doing a book signing in Manhattan on the 7th. And what's the best way to find it? It's on Eventbrite, but I'm not sure how you would find it. Ask me if you're interested, and I can tell you how to, find out all the details. We'd love to get lots of folks coming and learning about this message. This is just such a big moment, and if you were inspired by my presentation earlier and you want to help champion the food revolution message, one of the most powerful things you can do is to get this book and share it with friends and loved ones, especially in the first couple weeks after it comes out, because that's really how we spread it.
Okay, very good.
And Ocean, just the website that just you're connected with is called what?
Oh, foodrevolution.org is our main website for the Food Revolution Network.
Okay, great. Yeah, thanks. And Jeffrey, when did Secret Ingredients come out? I'm not sure if everyone knows about this documentary. Could you give us the details on that?
Yes, Secret Ingredients, a new movie by Amy Hart and me, came out in mid-November. And it's about families and individuals that heal from serious conditions when they switch to organic food. And it features the individuals, it features physicians that verify that the changes, in fact, were exactly what they see in their own offices every day. And the scientists explain why GMOs and Roundup may be the big culprits driving so many of the diseases. And that's secretingredientsmovie.com. It's also, Secret Ingredients is also in iTunes, Google Play, and Amazon. But you can go to the secretingredientsmovie.com, watch the trailer, and click over to any of those from there.
Just add to the Secret Ingredients. What we know is when kids with hyperactivity and ADHD go organic, 50% are healed. That's not good for the Ritalin industry, okay? And then, in my experience, we can get up to 90% healed when we do a few other things. But just going organic, 50% are healed.
Okay, and just also, if you want to follow up with Jeffrey, his website, instituteforresponsibletechnology.org.
It's actually responsibletechnology.org. That makes it easier.
Responsibletechnology.org. And I've been following them for many years. They are an incredibly action-oriented group. If you ever want to donate to someone in a responsible way to, you know, if you don't have the time to devote to dealing with the GMO issue and you want to support them, they use their money wiser than anyone, and they are unbelievably efficient in fighting for us, and we need the help. So maybe if you're moved by what you hear, maybe you'd consider going to their website and donating to support that cause. It's really valuable what they do.
What he said.
Yeah, what he said. Absolutely fabulous organization. If you want to make a difference on the GMO issue, there is no better cause to contribute to than Institute for Responsible Technology.
Thank you, Arshin. Thank you, Steve.
So to get started, there are some people that when we put these videos on YouTube, it's literally watched around the world. Like it'll be watched in 115 countries. And people watch for different lengths. Some people watch the entire time. Some just check it out. So assume that there's someone that is watching this. They've never seen you before. They don't know who you are. And after your opening comments, they're leaving and they're not interested again. And you've 3 minutes to sum up the most important things you've learned in life up to this point that you want to make sure they know. So for someone that is saying, I don't want the long story, I'm not reading your book, sum it up in 3 minutes. What is the most up-to-date, accurate, urgent information that you feel you want someone who's watching this video to make sure that they understand? Each of you could answer that.
Ocean, you're on that side. You're closer to the question.
Okay. We get no pressure. We have a toxic food culture. Feeling sick, having a high likelihood of dying of heart disease or cancer or dementia or suffering from type 2 diabetes may be typical, but it doesn't have to be normal. We now have more than 10,000 studies published in peer-reviewed medical journals, which tell us in no uncertain terms that we can radically extend not just the lifespan, but also the health span of millions of human beings just by applying what we already know. We need to eat less sugar and processed junk. We need to eat less animal products, particularly from factory farms. We need to eat more whole plant foods, and we need to more consciously source our foods by going organic, non-GMO, fair trade, and local. And when we make these kinds of changes, we make a powerful difference for our own health and well-being, and also for the well-being of the planet that we love. Every bite you take, every dollar you spend is a vote. You're voting for the health you want, and you're voting for the world you want. And so I want to invite you and challenge you to make that vote an informed vote and a conscious vote and an intentional vote. I used to take martial arts, and in martial arts, there's this concept of being centered. When you're centered, you can receive an impact and you don't fall over. When you're off center, you do. I believe that when we bring our food choices into integrity with our values, with our conscience, with our love, with our dreams, with our aspirations, our life takes on an integrity and a potency, and we become a force to be reckoned with. So I want to invite you to get informed, get empowered, and most importantly, put this food revolution into action so that you can have the health and the vitality and the joy and the vibrancy that you were born for and that you deserve, so you can give the precious gifts you're here to give and live the light you are here to live and share it with the whole world, because we need you. We need you healthy and well, and the right food choices can help you make that happen.
That was very eloquent. Nice. The whole way I look at life is about evolving spiritually. And eating at least an 80% live food, 100% organic, 100% plant-based diet is a powerful pillar to that. And you can't eat your way to God. So we kind of have to keep that in mind. And so the evolution and revolution of consciousness really does involve waking up physically, emotionally, mentally, and spiritually. If you don't have a properly functioning brain because you're eating processed and junk food, then you can't really attain your total purpose of being here, because your mind and brain isn't going to work as well. So eating this way that we're talking about can truly be a vehicle for elevating your consciousness. That's very important. When we go organic, and I'm going to say plant-based only, we are also ending cruelty to animals. We are making an incredible increase in overall health, 32% less heart disease. In terms of diabetes, 35 to 50% diabetes, and it goes down the line. So that's one piece. It also helps the planet, the ecology of the planet. Going plant-based, actually, even the United Nations and the World Health Organization has made it clear that that is the way to preserve the ecology of the world. So we're helping in many areas, and it is, as I said, the most important diet for supporting our spiritual awakening. So by eating this way, by leaving and living this way, we, our lives, our ways to be a blessing to uplift the planetary web of life. So I bless you all that you are willing to really go for it, to uplift yourself and uplift the planetary web of life on this planet. Amen.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jeffrey Smith, and for the last 23 years, I've been traveling and visiting 45 countries and interviewing dozens of scientists and doctors, and all about why GMOs are actually dangerous and how the industry and government have covered up the dangers, giving the impression that it's just food, but it's actually food-shaped objects that are quite dangerous. And about 15 years into my work, I was getting people telling me that they could actually tell the difference if they eat a GMO or not, and I was skeptical. I have to admit it, I had been talking about massive damage to rats, for example, in just 10 days on a GMO diet. And yet when people told me that they could tell the difference, I didn't believe them. But I had the good fortune of bringing the documented health risks of GMOs to the medical profession. And at one conference where I had spoke for 3 previous years, I showed up with a video camera. And I started interviewing the doctors, and many of them were prescribing non-GMO diets because of the lectures that they had heard. And they did not speak like scientists who are very conservative. They said GMOs cause inflammation, GMOs cause my patients to have more allergies. One woman said, I have all my patients go non-GMO and they all get better. And I was a little skeptical. I said, what percentage? She said, I said all, 100%. Okay, 98%. I said, how many patients have you prescribed an Anjimo diet to? She took a while and figured it out, and she said, 5,000. So I said, can I go to your clinic and ask the patients myself? And I brought a video camera, and I did it to her and to other places. And sure enough, the stories were amazing. And around the same time, I was visiting the farmers who had changed their pigs and cows to non-GMO, and their stories were amazing, and they matched. So I started asking audiences at 150 lectures, what did you notice when you switched to a non-GMO and largely organic diet? And sure enough, I got the same answer 150 times, including medical conferences where doctors talked about thousands of their patients having the same results. A whole slew of diseases and disorders get better. Then I surveyed 3,256 people, published it in a peer-reviewed journal, and sure enough, 28 conditions were reported as getting better, significantly better, and the same general frequency as the results I got in the lecture. And these were the similar problems that pet owners and veterinarians and farmers saw getting better in pets and livestock switched to non-GMO or organic. And these were the same problems, or their precursors, which were found in lab animals that were force-fed GMOs and the Roundup that sprayed on most GMOs. Now, if you look at it, there's actually more than 30 diseases rising in parallel with the increased use of GMOs and Roundup in the United States. Serious diseases, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, deaths from hypertension, deaths from obesity, different types of cancers. But if you look at each one of the diseases, you could find a plausible causative pathway linked directly to GMOs or the BT toxin insecticide produced by GMO corn or the Roundup herbicide sprayed on most GMOs. And you can take a look at the modes of action of those things and even predict that these particular diseases and disorders would be affected, either produced or exacerbated. So now we have a body of evidence that has convinced thousands of doctors to prescribe non-GMO diets, and here's the challenge. Please, when you go non-GMO and organic, and go all organic, not just non-GMO, because Roundup is now sprayed on a bunch of non-GMO crops, when you do that, take notes. Write down your symptoms and their severity, your energy level, your mood, behavior. All of these things have been shown to change. And see what happens after a few weeks. That will be far more convincing than anything I can say. Safe eating.
So, Jeffrey, you've been working on this for a lot of years. You've spoken, you've written books, you've written documentaries. Ocean, your dad and you have been on the front line for a long time. Dr. Cousens, you've been speaking about this for many years, treating people. You're not actually presenting brand new information tonight. You speak beautifully. I've seen you on TV shows. You're on The Doctors. So what's happening? What's happened when you speak to the senators, the congressmen, the president? Anyone, does anyone listen? Are they just ignoring it? Other people must have heard your information, seen your movies, read your books. So why hasn't someone said, okay, now that I know the information, I'm going to fix this. I'm going to write a law. I'm going to change things. Why hasn't this been solved already? What's preventing the information that you beautifully write and read and articulate from getting into the hands of people who say, we got to stop this. We care about the people.
Well, the status quo is profitable to the folks who are profiting from the status quo. And so there's not a lot of motivation to make change on behalf of the industries that are doing quite well financially in a society that has made money more important than human life or the survival of our planet itself. And that's the economic system we have created as human beings, is a system that values money over all else. And life and death are maybe factors on a PR portfolio or a balance sheet, but at the end of the day, it comes down to money. Now, I think money is value neutral, but absent ethics and integrity, it can become a source of real destruction because it makes a decent servant but a terrible master. And I think that we have, for example, a food industry. The way I look at it is food 1.0 is about survival. If you can get enough calories to fill your belly, then that's success. Food 2.0 is about commerce. The central organizing principle is the buying and selling of goods. My grandpa came up with 31 flavors of ice cream. In food 2.0, that's genius. Went from vanilla chocolate and strawberry to Rocky Road and Jamocha almond fudge and all the rest. But unfortunately, food 2.0 is morally bankrupt, which is why I'm saying we need food 3.0, which is health. And in my picture, there are plenty of healthy profits in food 3.0. They just come from healthy food because we make health for our bodies and our planet the central organizing principle of our food system. However, getting Nestle and McDonald's and Coca-Cola on board with that type of direction is a little tricky. And when I was meeting with a lot of food industry leaders, one of my core points was, you all are actually just out to make money for your shareholders selling food. You don't actually have a stake in Monsanto or biotechnology. You don't have a stake in pesticides. You don't have a stake in refined products. You would happily make money selling healthy food, right? And they were like, yeah, sure, absolutely, wherever the profit is, you know? And in fact, we would rather make money selling healthier food. And we're trying, they would say, you know? Coke came out with Diet Coke. So, you know, but I think that there is something about the large-scale industries that are so focused on delivering flavor and bottom possible price and lowest possible production costs that quality and health impact somehow get really short-shifted in the equation. And then we've got a medical industry that acts like food didn't matter. The average physician gets 19 hours of nutritional education in all of medical school. And most of that focuses on the symptoms of specific nutrient deficiencies. It doesn't actually focus on what to eat. There are only, out of 150 medical schools in America, there are only four that have a single faculty staff member with a focus on nutrition. So it's really treated like a tiny, tiny, tiny little side note. And 19% of our GDP is going to disease symptom management. There's a lot more money in that, quite frankly, than there is in health. From a medical standpoint, I have a feeling that if broccoli was reimbursed like chemotherapy is, we would see more broccoli eaten and we would see less cancer deaths. But unfortunately, we're not there yet. So we are up against some established interests and some entrenched interests that are profiting from a status quo. And unfortunately, our government is more accountable to donors than to voters, or certainly than to public welfare. And so as long as the money is in the hands of established interests, it's going to be tough to create change from the establishment level. However, that doesn't mean we can't change what we eat, what we buy, and build a new food economy. And that's one of the things that is heartening to me. And even in the GMO struggle, you know, with all the, Jeffrey and I worked together on a lot of ballot initiatives for GMO labeling in a series of states. And while the biotechnology industry typically out fundraised and outspent us by about 5-1, I will say that that one was a lot better than zero, and it predominantly came from the natural foods sector that was passionate about this issue and that is growing in influence and even in political clout. So I think we are building a new economy, actually, and that every dollar we spend invests in a direction monetarily that either fuels more of the same or something different. And I choose to invest my energy, my attention, my time, and my financial resources in every way possible in creating something healthier and better.
Very nice. I really like that. I have an opportunity to speak in many places around the world, and I couldn't help but notice in Argentina where people living in the area where they're doing GMO with the glyphosate kind of spraying, that they have 100 times more miscarriages and 5 times more incidence of congenital defects. Couldn't help but notice that, as well as infertility. What I also couldn't help notice is the doctors were really upset and actually did a march and were really protesting. So I think that's interesting. I don't know if you heard about that, but that's an area I work in. So what I'm saying is, around the world, there is somewhat of a movement, which is good. There's something like 64 countries that actually have labeling of GMO, okay? And 38 countries where they're outlawed. I think that's really important. You can't do GMO in Russia, for example. Can't do it. It's illegal. So there is hope here on a world scale. Now, who are the top producers? The United States and Brazil, then Argentina, then Canada. So we are, in a sense, the belly of the beast, so it is harder. But it's good to see the bigger picture, that there are really concerned people, really upset people, including doctors, who just, you don't need to have a nutrition course to figure out what's going on. And so there's really good news about it in the bigger picture. So there are, around the world, a force that really cares about the people from the medical point of view and really political point of view. So I just want to give that kind of note. And it's growing. We will defeat it. It's really against humanity. There's a statement in the Bible, the Torah, Genesis 1:12, which says something, it speaks directly to it, actually. It says the vegetables and the grasses of the field and the fruits of the seed-bearing tree are to be made, this is Genesis 1:12, to be alike. In other words, they're not supposed to, the DNA is not supposed to be altered, is what it says. Okay, in same kind. So there's a deeper issue going on a spiritual level of we are not supposed to alter the DNA of God's creation. I'll put it as simple as that. Look it up, Genesis 1, Bereshit 1, 12. So, it's in kind is what it says. So that's a key spiritual component that eventually will overwhelm the economic, the short term, because it is short term, the economic things of creating good food so people can be healthy, with healthy minds and healthy bodies. So kind of the bigger picture, but understand the spiritual aspect of it. You're not supposed to change the DNA. It's a, hate to say it, but what it is, it's satanic, literally. Those who want to change the DNA are violating the whole divine plan. So there are huge spiritual forces going on to understand this on a deeper level. So no, this will happen. We have to play our role. We have to make enough noise on our part, which is what you're saying, and create enough good food to make a difference. So another little piece is how to talk about food. And they play a lot of games with labeling. So we've created a term called authentic food. What is that? Food that is grown locally within 3 days because everything else, food loses its energy. Give it 3 days, it's going to lose its energy. And it has to be organic, but also not transported, not bumped around, and, in trucks and so forth. So that is a way of thinking about it, growing locally. The minute we grow locally, farmers make more money than selling healthy food. So if we can get to the local farmers, say, you're going to make more money, go organic, you're going to produce more because the GMO promise didn't happen. We're going to make more food for more people. It's not true. This GMO is maybe equal to or 10% less in terms of productivity. So if we, like you were saying here, put our money where our literally our mouth is and buy authentic organic food, locally grown, we start to move away from the bigger food industries, which I think is a very key concept here, supporting the local agriculture. So that's just another insight, and supporting the spiritual insight into this is really, again, we're not supposed to change the DNA. That's not our job. That's against the divine plan. GMOs are against the divine plan. So just an added way of thinking about it. Very good. Very good.
So, Stephen, the way you frame the question, it's almost as if, in my mind, you gave too much power to the policymakers. You said, I have talked to members of Congress and Senate and head of state and ministers and all over the world. And I can tell you that what has driven more than those meetings, even though many of the people that I've spoke with are in complete agreement, is the change in the purchasing power. It's the actual and perceived change. When Arpad Pusztai, a top scientist in his field, when he was ungagged by his boss and could finally talk about the health dangers of GMOs, it was picked up by the European press. Over 700 articles were written within a month in the UK. There was so much agitation in the European press about GMOs that 10 weeks after the gag order was lifted, on April 27th, 1999, Unilever said no more GMOs in Europe. The next day, Nestle said no more GMOs in Europe. And then the next day, and the next day, and the next day, the rest of the giants crumbled for Europe. Because that whole episode that was the basis for hundreds of articles was not covered at all in the United States press. And the same companies that took GMOs out of Europe continued to sell GMOs to unsuspecting Americans. So we educated Americans directly through so many channels, and people did not need to get their messaging from the muted mainstream press. We got to them. And now 46% of Americans seek non-GMO food, according to the survey. And that's more than we need to start the tipping point in the United States. It is underway. The food companies realize they cannot withstand a competitor with a non-GMO claim on the same shelf as their brand without it. And so brand after brand after brand is becoming non-GMO. So do I want to try and change the FDA policy as the way I spend my time, knowing that it was Monsanto's former attorney and later vice president who was put in a position to be in charge of FDA policy and came up with a GMO policy saying, don't ask, don't tell. You don't have to submit it for evaluation. You can decide whether it's safe, and we won't have to label it. Or the EPA that allowed the glyphosate, the active ingredient in Monsanto's Roundup, to pass with flying colors, and we find out now because of the documents made public because of the lawsuit, they had a lapdog in the EPA who was working on their behalf in charge of the cancer committee. And we have, he even said, if I can stop this other agency's evaluation of carcinogenicity of glyphosate, I deserve a medal. He said that to his Monsanto handler. And we have the email from one Monsanto man to the other talking about praising Jess Rowland of the EPA. Do I want to go after the mainstream media knowing that they have been biased? Do I want to go after top academia that has been a major focus of Monsanto's disinformation campaign? Or the farmers who get most of their information from the seed companies, the chemical companies, the biotech industry, they're all the same thing. And the land-grant universities and the agents that do the bidding for the biotech industry. Do I want to go after them? Monsanto's stronghold, Monsanto now Bayer. That's not where the power lies. The power lies in a mother protecting her children. And the way to motivate that power is with the truth. So in this movie, Secret Ingredients, we'll show it to a room full of people at a festival or a premiere, and virtually everyone in the audience wants to change their diet to be more organic, and they want to tell their friends who they think are suffering from a disease related to GMOs and Roundup after they've gotten the truth. So, Stephen, the answer is we are actually winning in the GMO battle, and we can win even if we don't change government policy.
Okay, so the next question I have is, assuming that we somehow got in a situation where the politicians were completely open-minded, or let's change that. Assume you had full control over the country. Just so I'm clear, so we're just very clear with the specifics, what are the five most powerful policies we would want to be made if we had full control over the laws that this country made? What would be, if someone ever said, so what exactly do you want? What are the five things exactly we want to tell our politicians we want? And then the second question is, in what are the five steps that we as individuals should take to have the most power? So not a motivational speech, not a theoretical discussion. Specifically, what are the five things we want to tell the politicians that we are the most important things, and what are the five things that are the most powerful thing that any of us could do for the food system overall?
Ocean!
That's a complex question.
So, if I had total power, like I was an absolute dictator, I would probably think bigger than I even can think now, because I think in terms of what I see as being somewhat politically feasible. I'm interested in what's practical, not like my dream come true utopia. Not that I don't want to bridge the gap between where we are and where we want to be, but I think practically about what gap bridging potential exists in my lifetime more than like, you know, heaven on earth sometimes, maybe a limit of my imagination. But I think that within that context, from a food standpoint, I would policy-wise end government subsidies through the farm bill of the commodity system and instead direct financial resources to support the accessibility of healthy foods, especially for low-income communities, so that it becomes, you can't afford not to eat kale because it's cheaper than the other stuff and more widely available. I would also relatedly insert taxes on those foods that are detrimental to public health and the environment, so that you actually pay the real price per pound for what foods actually cost the society, rather than essentially offloading or outsourcing those costs to the planet and future generations. Take this, the food stamp program, and I would create some limitations on what it covers so that it's not covering sugary soft drinks and junk food, but I would also make it so that it doubles or triples value for fruits and vegetables and whole foods, again, to really incentivize and encourage consumption of those foods in low-income communities. I would help food banks to all be well-stocked with healthy foods. You can see there's a trend here. I'm interested in changing the economics of it so that the lowest income communities have access to healthy food. I would also ban factory farms. I'd do that tomorrow. We could phase it in. We could phase it in over the course of a little bit of time so that the animals have somewhere to go. But the next step would be, you know, that if animals are going to be raised for food, they need to be treated decently and humanely, and it needs to be done sustainably. And then I would develop a massive task force focused on regenerative agriculture and how we can sequester carbon out of the atmosphere and get it back into the soil so that we can replenish our topsoil to have more spongy topsoil that's more drought resistant, that's more abundant and fertile, and so that we can grow food for future generations while also sequestering carbon and drawing down and making being a carbon sink to help stabilize the climate for the future of life on Earth. That's all just my top things in the world of food, policy-wise.
I think when I'm president, I'm going to have him head of the Department of Agriculture. Okay, so in a simple way, I would pass a law that only organic food is allowed to be grown. Now, it's actually cheaper. When you understand that organic food has 25% more nutrient, it's 80% more antioxidants, it has 20% more phenols, and it has considerably more minerals in it, it's actually cheaper. So that'd be one law I would pass. Make it simple. Only organic food. In terms of the food, the way cattle are grown, literally, when you're eating the factory farm cattle, you're increasing, there's a virus in it, or not like mad cow disease, called TD43. And basically, if you're eating that, you're going to at least double your rate of Alzheimer's disease. And Alzheimer's disease is a lot. When they've really done autopsy studies, what we see is about 13% of Alzheimer's is actually mad cow disease. And TDP43 is a much greater amount. So all the factory farm animals are distinctly destroying people's minds and accelerating cognitive decline and inflammation. So hey, that's a huge resource of humans, because the rate of Alzheimer's disease is happening sooner, earlier, and earlier, and it's connected to this. So all this saves a tremendous amount of money, pain, and misery, and is helping human evolution. So those would be the two things, at least, I would do. Just get rid of the factory farm animals and go back to whatever kind of nutrition is there, but not really, I would outlaw factory farm because of the high rate of mental degeneration associated with TDP43. So those are really two broad sweeping things that would make a difference. All organic and no factory farm foods. And if that happened, I'd be happy to stop there.
But Jeffrey has another step, I am
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, I think I got a little more. But, you know, I'm gonna just focus in my area because and what I do is I study and expose how the corporations have skewed the research, the reporting, the policy, everything. And so the first thing I would do would be to eliminate the impact of corporate dollars and corporate influence on all areas of our lives. Agriculture, education, media, medicine, all of politics. And it's amazing, and to actually, for issues that are related to our health and to our life and lifespan, that we create policies based on improving health, not on selling medicines or whatever. And so what's interesting is that one of my recommendations or implementations comes from the recommendation of a panel of more than 400 scientists that worked for years on the behest of the United Nations to create the most comprehensive evaluation of how to feed the world, called the ISTAD report. And their recommendation was agroecology. which you could consider to be appropriate, sustainable, organic in this country. And what I would do is I would change the entire food supply so that it would not just be organic, but it would be regenerative organic, diverse, nutrient dense, soil restoring. And what would happen with that is that we would see, first of all, the sequestration of carbon, for sure, and we would see a reduction in disease like we had never seen before. And I think, again, I think I'll just start with those two, because five is a lot. And then you wanted five more about what people can do. I'll give you some ideas. I wrote a book called Seeds of Deception in 2003, and it became the world's best-selling book on GMOs, translated in all these languages. And when I came out with my last film 7 years ago, Genetic Roulette, in 1 week, with 1.2 million views online, it way surpassed anything, any readership that I had gotten with the book. So I realized movies were critical, both the short movies that get zillions of views and the longer ones that totally make the case and leave you different. And so I spent much of my last 4 years with Amy Hart creating the film Secret Ingredients. Because I would want to mandate on high, be organic, but demand can do it too. So this film turns out to be, in my opinion and in my educated opinion, the most effective conversion tool to organic yet created. That virtually everyone says, okay, I'm ready to go organic, because they see it has healed people. There is a chiropractic clinic in the Midwest. They had 93 infertile couples. They all put them all in an organic diet. 100% of them have children. There are two families with autistic sons, no longer autistic. David Perlmutter's in there talking about the link between GMOs and Roundup and the microbiome and umpteen diseases. And so at the end of that, you realize, oh my God, I have been poisoning myself or my family. What's life going to be like on the other side of an organic diet? So I'd like to recommend that you, I know some of you watching this are really foodies. You're already organic, so this is an interesting recommendation. Show it to the people who you love, the people who've been running away from you for years because you're showing up, you're ready to convince them, and this is the new study, and they're going, not anymore. Just sit down and watch the film with them. I had someone come up to me and say, this convinced my daughter after so much, or this convinced my husband. So please use it as a tool, because we can't dictate on high, but we can dictate from down here, where life happens, in our own lives, in our own stomachs, in our families. And that knowledge has organizing power, so that choice needs some firepower behind it. And that's why I would suggest, that's why I spent the time doing Secret Ingredients, and Amy Hart did a magnificent job as the detailed person, the detailed director. I am very happy with the results, and we want to create an organic tidal wave. Please help. Thank you.
Just as a little footnote for people worried about carbon dioxide, 1 acre of organic farming will remove 3,700 pounds of carbon out of the atmosphere in a year. And if you do 1 acre of avocado, 5,200 pounds of carbon dioxide will be pulled out. So we regenerate the soil, and actually it's really good for us. But going organic changes everything in a very big way. That's just a little tidbit to support that. We're the consumers. If we demand organic, that's the bottom line. When we stopped the whole battle about they were irradiating food and people refused to buy irradiated food, that was the end of it, pretty much the end of it. Now they've done a few other things. But if everybody demands organic, things will shift that way. Where I live, you can get a full range of organic food at Safeway. When you live near the Mexican border and, you know, Nogales, you can go there. That's anywhere. So realize we make a huge difference as consumers. Going in the simple way, we can change really the whole industry, the food industry, by demanding the healthy foods.
So go ahead.
I was just going to add one more policy change. This is actually smaller scale and could totally happen. Not that all of this couldn't, but this could happen even in the current political environment without too big a change. Right now, if a farmer wants to grow their food organically and get certified, they have to jump through a bunch of regulatory hoops and pay for certification. And if a farmer wants to spray their crops with neurotoxic pesticides and herbicides and fungicides, they don't. And so essentially, we're putting the regulatory burden on the people who are being safer, and it's kind of like being fined for wearing your seatbelt. And so I say, if we just straight up shifted that, and the people using the poisons had the regulatory burden, and the people who were growing organic didn't, then that would change the economics of it overnight. And suddenly organic food would be competitive, if not more affordable than the alternatives.
Brilliant. Brilliant.
So if someone walks out of this lecture, we'd like to summarize with saying that we're recommending you're recommending they avoid all GMO foods. You're saying stop eating animal products. And you're saying eat only organic. I'm not sure if that's what you said, but that's what my thought. All right, so I guess, are you agreeing that those three things, avoid GMOs, stop eating animal products, eat only organic, and can you add to that list? If someone says, is going home to their spouse or wants to know for themselves, can we make that list, can we add to that list anything else that you feel would be key components for personal responsibility that would make a big difference?
I mean, my big four are eat less sugar and processed junk, eat more whole plant foods, eat less animal products, especially from factory farms, and source consciously with organic, non-GMO, fair trade, local, et cetera. So those are the big things that I focus on and advocate for. And I think if we move in that direction, we can transform millions of lives in short order. Then, of course, we're talking food here, and that's the focus, but we know there's more to health than food, right? There's exercise and movement. I think Dean Ornish says we need to eat better, stress less, love more, and move more, right? That's his big four prescription. And it's worked, you know. His program was the first to document that we could not only prevent but reverse even the most severely developed heart disease, just with those four principles. Atherosclerosis rates were dropped by 81% amongst patients with severe heart disease just by adopting the Ornish program. It's better than any drug that's been developed without any of the negative side effects, only good side effects like a better sex life and more vitality and energy and less risk of cancer and dementia.
Well, I like everything you said. So I agree with it. I tend to want to go a little simpler. Because if we just go organic, I have a whole slideshow on GMO. And in the end of the story, is the only thing I could say is, go local organic. That's really it. And then you cut through everything. So that's one thing. You know, I talk about what I call the six foundations, which is an 80%. Live and 100% plant-based, and doing exercise, including breathing exercise, which we'll be teaching tomorrow morning, and the yoga and the tai chi and qigong, and then service and charity, which opens up your heart and helps the connectivity, and seeing us all as equal souls in the process, the fourth step. And meditating, and praying, and working collectively, it really makes a huge difference. We know that when people are part of a group, they do live longer, and they have about half as much depression. They're very real things, and they're really simple things. So those are things. The other part, corollary of that, I call it sevenfold peace, and peace with the body, which we've mostly been talking about, and then peace with the mind, and what we eat affects our mind. Now, when you take in animal, well, even if it's an organically grown animal, there's still pain, misery, and suffering. And you're going to take that pain, misery, and suffering into you because that is the last moment of that animal's life. So you're creating pain, misery, suffering in yourself and the diseases that come with that. That's a big kind of thing in the picture. And the third is sacred relationships, the importance of family, the importance of the sacred relationship between two people, the really importance of lineage, and also community. Right now, in the United States, but really many places in the world, the society's in chaos. Can we be in right relationship with that, the right detente with that, that we're not being negatively affected and we can uplift it, thinking the positive. And then we talk about cultural. And I, from a Native American point of view, use the word Om Takuasin, means to all my relations. The rock people, the living earth, the plant people, the animal, flying, swimming ones, and the human cultures, and then all the human cultures. So if we're in right relationship with that, it changes a whole lot. And then we have spiritual ecology, which we've been alluding to, and then peace with the divine. So when you combine all this together, you're creating a total matrix from which we can bring forth healthy living on all levels. So that's kind of the bigger picture, the simple picture. If you go organic, you're going to solve a lot of problems right there. If you go authentic, that's really good in terms of that. And if you're doing all the six foundations, sevenfold peace, you're really creating a multi-leveled space for the evolutionary upgrade of all humanity. So that's enough.
I don't take a position on which type of diet, vegetarian, paleo, keto, fasting, intermittent fasting, whatever. My strategy has been to keep the bar as low as possible to become non-GMO. And it's worked. By focusing so much on the health dangers, the behavior change messaging, and getting it out there, we have made a huge change in the United States and around the world. So I don't actually take a position on politics, on anything other than what I am focusing on, because I don't need to create any more controversy. I don't need you to agree with any of my politics or any of my dietary philosophies except avoid GMOs and go organic as well. Now, many people ask me the question for years, well, in addition to changing your diet, is there anything else you can do to heal your body? And I'd always say the exact same thing. It's above my pay grade. I'm not a doctor or a scientist, I don't have patients, and I don't have a degree to help you. But then I started talking to doctors and scientists who are actually focusing on it, who developed supplements that actually reduce the amount of glyphosate in human urine, supplements that close the gaps of the human cells that were open because of glyphosate, who had created research protocols to detox the body through a variety of ways, even a Roundup or glyphosate detox protocol, and I realized I have to share this information. Now, I'm not qualified to answer the questions, but I'm overqualified to ask them. So I gathered 18 experts and asked them, how do you heal from GMOs and Roundup? And at healingfromgmos.com, we put together a conference, and we released it, and about 60,000 people online attended it, and they loved it, and they had all sorts of recommendations, and it was exciting. But I don't generally repeat those recommendations. I'll just make that healing from GMOs available so you can get it directly from them. But that's over and above. But there's one other thing I want to share, because you asked what is it beyond those three things. And that is my experience, and I know many other people's experience, to take on a global issue and don't shy away from being a leader. How many in the audience feel like there's something bigger for you brewing, but you haven't yet said fully yes to it or discovered it? Raise your hand. Okay, so most of you. And how many people believe that fear might be something that needs to be handled in order to get to the other side of that? Okay, so I'm going to share one point here. My experience is there's a part of us that has a calling, that knows what to do, and even to a large part, how to do it. And we cower in a smaller part of ourselves, and only within the smaller part of ourselves do we have the gap of fear. But when we fully step up and embody and embrace that part of us which says yes to our destiny, yes to our calling, yes to how we want to make an impact on the world, it's as if we go to the place of fearlessness. I remember in Taiwan, I think someone said, "Mr. Smith, I want to thank you for being so brave." And I said, "Actually, I'm not brave." For bravery, you need to have fear, and bravery will step through it. I don't have any fear. I am honored to do this work. And I'll tell you, when you step up, and I can ask the other, my colleagues on the table here, the panel, if it's your experience as well, when you step up to truly be a leader and a change agent and accept that, not only does the fear drop away, but it's like an advanced technique. The rough edges of the personality drop off because you don't have time for them. You've got to, you're holding a much bigger platform. So I would like to, you're seeing person after person, leader after leader for 10 days at this amazing conference. And I'm saying, beyond what they say, let them inspire you so that that voice in you that's saying, do more, say, yes, I will, and leap to that place of fearlessness. Don't push against it, just leap to it and see what happens in your life.
So when everyone goes home, we're going to basically have a list that says avoid all GMOs, stop eating all animal products, although Jeffrey is not taking that position, but Gabriel and Ocean are. Eat only organic, and not only eat organic, but buy it buy locally grown organic. So it's far more desirable to go to the Union Square Farmers Market and buy from the guy from 50 miles away than buy stuff that came from California. So if those are the four...
Hey, I'm from California, so...
me too. Well,
taking offense at that. No.
If you're from California, buy from California.
So in addition to those four points, are we also saying that to fix the food system, that everyone should try to grow some of their own food? Are we saying that it's important to use heirloom seeds versus hybridized seeds? Are we saying that when you buy a whole food, like a potato versus a potato chip, you working an organic potato only connects you to a farmer where potato chips involves snack companies? Are we saying to drink water because soda involves high fructose corn syrup and we don't want people growing corn for that? Are any of those things part of this four-point list we've made?
Sure.
You want to comment on any of them or just all of them?
I couldn't agree more. I mean, it's part of the whole... There are the implications of everything that has been said here. That's the key. That they're just implied. I think that's fair to say.
And I want to address the diversity of people responding to this information. When some people watch secret ingredients, they get to the cupboard stage, which is they go to the cupboard and they empty everything that's not organic and they refill it. Some people, it's like they're devastated by the fact about throwing out food because of their own economic situation or cultural situation, so it's more of attrition. When this thing runs out, we'll get an organic one. And I would say the list is great of try and get all the different pieces together. But we also need to understand that we've been operating under the tyranny of the shoulds for much of our lives. We should do this and should do that, and we all have a relationship to our own tyrant. I would say joyously step into a healthy life. Joyously take the steps as you shop and figure out. There's one thing that I would like to suggest that often comes up with the question, but isn't organic too expensive? But I think I can bring it into this question as well. I say, in addition to all the tips and tricks and things to get things less expensively and make healthier choices more easy, I say combine three budgets in your mind: your food budget, your health budget, and your philanthropy budget. Food is obvious, that's what you're buying. Health, not so obvious until you realize that people actually spend less on medical care when they switch to a healthier diet, by far. I spoke to one family, it went from $18,000 a year to $9,000 in 1 year of organic to $3,000 in 2 years in organic. That may be excessive, but I've heard spoken to many people where they make more money on saving in healthcare than they spend on organic. But also there's the philanthropy. This is where the joy in spending comes, because you're now investing in the organic farmer. You're investing in the healthy local system. You're investing in a new world. And so some people, it's interesting, I'm gonna probably name some of you. Probably you're gonna go, uh-oh, that's me. At the end of the year, you make a check out to 100 or 1,000 or 10,000 or whatever the number is, and then you work like crazy to save money and not buy organic because it's too expensive throughout the year. Take some of that 10,000 or whatever you give in donations, take some of that and put it into your food budget so that you realize you are investing in a changed world. And that way there's more joy and there's more power in what you're doing day to day.
I appreciate what you said. I'm getting back to the fear issue. And in terms of relationship, love is the power that helps you overcome the fear of intimacy. Just think about that for a second. And if we take it a step further, which is loving yourself enough to want to heal yourself, your love for yourself and love for humanity is the power that helps you overcome your fear. So those are things to think about. I'm not sure that there isn't some fear there in some way, but you're loving yourself enough to want to heal yourself. And that's something to think about. I'm going to just share a funny story. In 1973, when I went vegan, is my wife and I, she was pregnant, we both had this nightmare. And the nightmare is that the fetus, our daughter, who's 46 now, was a chicken, and we were eating it. And the next, that's it. We both became vegan. One day.
Did you have this simultaneous dream at the same time?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I've never heard of that.
It's trippy. So it's very funny. But it's true. True story. Now, generally, people kind of move at their rate. You know, we give up. You may have heard me talk this morning about fat from fish is specifically toxic to the beta cells of the pancreas. People eating fish, you know, two times a week are going to have a lot more diabetes. And why meat is 35 to 50%. Meat eaters are going to get a 35 to 50% more diabetes. It has to do with the leucine in the meat, which is toxic to the beta cells of the pancreas. I'm short condensing it. And also the fat. and the meat and the fat and the fish. So we have things that, okay, they're really destructive. And so we look at what are we going to let go first, you know, fish and then chicken and then beef. And then we look at beans and we look at grain, look at dairy. And then you look at beans and grains, things like that. So you're slowly moving that way. That may take you 4 years. It may take you one day, depending on what kind of neighbor you had, okay? So understand there's a tradition, there's a transition that people go through. And you really do need to go at your own rate, which is what you're saying. But a key element is loving yourself enough to want to heal yourself. That's a very important, very, very important motivation to begin thinking about. So I'm just kind of adding that as a perspective. And then the rate is kind of up to you, how you do it. So just a way of thinking about it. So good.
Ocean, I have an article here. Would you like to read it instead of me? A long article, and it's I think it talks about the food industry. Would you like to read it?
Depending what it says.
Well, maybe Ocean could be writing an article like that. Maybe we.
I think it matches your view. So this is the. See if I can get rid of this.
The article says avoiding meat and dairy is single biggest way to reduce your impact on Earth. Biggest analysis to date reveals...
Hold on, I have a question.
This is from The Guardian.
If you tell us where it is, we could find it, but I'd rather that Ocean give his perspective since he just wrote a whole book on it. Can I...
Sure, whatever you guys
okay.
like.
Can I just ask a question in terms of people's concentration? Would this be where halfway through a good time to take a little stretch break so people can fully focus? Does that feel okay to our panel here? So people can really hear what's going on? Let's take a little stretch break.
Sure, although it's quite an article.
Okay, we're going to start again. So everyone, please, we're going to resume. He'll join us. We need to resume. Okay, so the article I gave Ocean, you can read it, you can comment on it, you could interpret it and start a whole new conversation and explain what I was getting at. But basically the question is, what impact does eating animal products have on everything, on the environment, on the water, on the land, on the forest, on the oceans, on ocean acidification, on coral reefs, on everything? And I was wondering if you could either read it or instead tell us the answer to the question, what impact does eating animal products have on all aspects of the food system, the environment, etc.?
Well, this is pretty, it is quite a fascinating article, and I hadn't read it before, so I am going to give you a summary of it, but I won't actually read it per se. So a study published in the journal Science created a data set of almost 40,000 farms in 119 countries, covering 40 food products, representing 90% of all that is eaten. It assessed the full impact of these foods from farm to fork on land use, climate change emissions, freshwater use, and water pollution, as well as air pollution. It was the largest study of this kind ever conducted, and it found that livestock provide 18% of humanity's calories and 37% of humanity's protein, but take up 83% of the world's farmland. They found that without meat and dairy consumption, global farmland use could be reduced by 75%, an area equivalent to the US, China, European Union, and Australia combined, and still feed the world. They found that 86% of all land mammals are now livestock or humans. 86% of the land mammals on Earth are either humans or the livestock we raise. 14% are wild creatures. And they determined that, let's see, there's some other remarkable things. Beef results in 105 kilograms of greenhouse gases per 100 grams of meat, while tofu produces less than 3.5 kilograms. So tofu is about 3.5% the carbon impact of beef. In terms of carbon impact, by the way, beef is the most extreme. Crustaceans farmed are next. Lamb and mutton is next. But yeah, all of the least carbon impactful foods are peas and pulses and nuts and tofu. And so very interesting. We're talking particularly here, I think, about protein sources. So anyway, enough on the article, I think, from there. But you get the point. The UN Food and Agriculture Organization also, you know, looked at this some years ago, and they ended up determining that cows impact our climate more than cars do. You may be wondering, why? Is it because cows leave the lights on too much at night after they go to bed? Do they turn the heat up and not turn it down? No. It's because livestock is a very inefficient way to feed humanity. It's kind of a protein factory in reverse. It takes 12 pounds of grain or soy to produce 1 pound of feedlot beef. It takes about 5 or 6 to produce chicken or pig. The others are essentially wasted. They turn into hoof, hide, bone, manure, energy the animal uses to move and breathe, and not into food for humans. So when you're taking large amounts of agricultural land and cycling it through livestock, there's a lot of waste involved. Pasture land, while potentially and theoretically more sustainable, often isn't, because a lot of it is rainforest or forest land that has been chopped down or burned so we can create grazing land. And then sometimes that pasture land also has to be irrigated in order to keep the grass green and growing so the cows have something to eat. All of that irrigation takes a lot of water, and all of that land could be doing other things like being forest or growing food for humans in many cases. There are some places where you've got grass that couldn't really grow anything else. And theoretically, well-managed certain livestock could live there. Like we had buffalo in the United States hundreds of years ago, and they were quite sustainable. So it's not that hoofed creatures are inherently bad for the planet, but livestock raising the way we are doing it is, in a massive way. And so I think one of the core points of this article is we talk a lot about how we're going to feed the world, and one of the biggest arguments for GMOs is the fallacy that it will lead to better yields. It's actually not true. But it's Monsanto now. Bayer has gotten a lot of mileage out of that, saying, oh, do you want hungry people to starve? You know, what if this technology could help feed a hungry world? And certainly pesticides and herbicides and fungicides have been justified on those grounds. And it is true that chemical-intensive agriculture in the short run can produce higher yields per acre than organic can in the short run. But at what cost in the long run? And maybe we don't even need to maximize every possible bit of yield and mortgage our children's future and our own health in the process if we ate less meat.
Okay. I couldn't agree more. I kind of look at it simple ways. A vegan saves a swimming pool full of water each year, 1.5 million gallons. Just think about that. Try drinking that much. In terms of the energy things, somewhere between 12 and all, some people say even 22% more, not 28 times more energy is used up. There's some variations, but it's a lot, okay, which is the point, you know. It's like, wait, we got energy, we got water, we got air pollution. And, you know, one Mac burger destroys 55 square feet of rainforest. This is not the way to do things. And when you run protein through the cow, you're losing 90%, as you say, in reverse. So, like, this is not serving us, and certainly not in the long run, which is key here. It doesn't work in the short run either, but definitely not in the long run. So if we're going to preserve the planet, and I, again, we'll tell you, the World Health Organization, European Nutrition Organization have all said, they didn't use the word vegan, they just said, we need to go towards a plant-based diet. So there is a kind of a consensus. It's not like that far out. That was in 2010, where, you know, the European Union and their nutritional kind of advice, you got to go towards a plant-based diet if we're going to save the planet. They don't make a big noise about it, but that's what we're talking about. So it is acknowledged in the highest circles of what, political circles of what has to be done. We're the ones that make the difference, though. We go that way, that's the way it's going to go. So it's up to us to educate as much as possible about all these things for the survival of the species. That's probably the simple way to say it. So think about it that way. The data's there. Are people listening? We got to get people to listen to it.
And I will take the question as the environmental impact of GMOs and non-organic agriculture. So there are a lot of specific details, ways in which GMOs and Roundup cause havoc. Roundup is an antibiotic. It kills the beneficial bacteria in our gut, but also the beneficial bacteria in the soil, changing the microbiome, promoting soil-borne pathogens, making future yields less successful in the ground. It can be stuck in the ground for decades without breaking down depending on the soil constituents. It has damaged the monarch butterfly population and the honeybee population and compactified soil causing runoff. It's 18% phosphorus, so it's also building up phosphorus and causing more runoff of that. The genetically modified salmon might wipe out natural salmon. The genetically modified mosquitoes might create havoc in the ecosystem. Bt toxin can damage all sorts of insects, and quote, non-target insects. It's supposed to kill some, it's not supposed to kill others, but it does. And it changes the ecosystem. So there's all sorts of ways in which the specific toxin of Roundup, the specific toxin of Bt causes problems. And I can go into each for an hour without stopping. But there's another one that you need to know, which is even more serious. And that is pollution of the gene pool. Pollution of the gene pool. When you release a genetically modified organism into the environment and it cross-pollinates and it passes its genes on to those future generations, we don't have a technology today to clean that up. Monsanto's stated goal, according to its consultant, who spoke at a 1999 biotech conference in San Francisco, they asked the Monsanto executives to describe their ideal future in 15 to 20 years, and the executives described a world in which 100% of all commercial seeds were genetically engineered and patented. The consultant worked backwards from that goal to create the strategy and tactics to achieve it. That goal, though slowed down in its fulfillment by consumer rejection, the goal has actually expanded. Now, with gene editing techniques, everything with DNA is a target. Gene editing is cheap, and it is very disruptive. It causes unpredicted side effects, and there's plenty of evidence that's being ignored about it. But there is a gold rush now going on into the genome, a gene rush, with all of these companies trying to identify and patent gene combinations. And once you patent it, the timer starts and you have to get the invention out into the marketplace and receive money before the patent expires. And the main goal of the biotech industry now is to try to portray gene editing as so safe, so precise, they should just call it breeding, and it shouldn't be linked to GMOs. Think what could happen. Virtually everything with DNA is a target. Once it's introduced, you cannot recall it. We are looking at the possibility of the biotech industry replacing nature in this generation, replacing the products of the billions of years of evolution with their designer organisms designed for greater profit and control. And the number one most common result of genetic engineering is surprise side effects. There is nothing like it. The only thing that lasts longer than genetic pollution is extinction. It is an A-plus priority, and it has been thrust upon us by the state of the science and the lack of wide-scale thinking and the focus on profits. So the damage that we are talking about is something that we will pass on to our great, 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 great grandchildren. The good news is that we can, individually and as a group, as a movement, protect all living beings and all future generations. And no one in human history has had that opportunity, because there has not been a technology that has been that devastating, potentially, for all things with DNA. So consider that an amazing resume builder, helped protect all living beings for all future generations. What an opportunity. And it's something that's, we didn't necessarily choose it as a generation, but it's right here. So now that you know, what are you going to do?
What is that called? It's not GMOs, it's called gene editing?
No, it's a GMO. This is one of their things. Your question was, it's not a GMO? No, it is a GMO. It is a GMO. Gene editing is GMO, okay? Right. It is a GMO. What happens is, traditionally, in the earlier stages of genetic engineering, they would grab a gene from, let's say, soil bacteria that would create a poison that breaks holes in the insect's stomach and kills it, make millions of copies, coat tungsten or gold pellets, put it into a gun, shoot it into a plate of cells, corn cells, let's say, and then hope that some of those genes make it into the DNA of some of those cells. That's their precise level of insertion. Then they'd clone it or go through tissue culture, which would cause massive more collateral damage in the DNA, and then they'd have a GMO. So here, what they do is they use genetic scissors to cut the genome in certain places, and when it recombines, it creates mutations and other things. They may insert their cut prospects in through bacteria, and then they create the cloning or the tissue culture, which again creates massive collateral damage in the DNA. And they have a computer model which says, if you do this, these are the side effects. And based on the computer model, they're acceptable or not. But when they actually do the gene sequencing, it's not at all what the computer model told them. It's far worse. And very few people know that because they're just into, oh, it's safe, and they don't look at the actual empirical data. So it is a GMO, and the biggest campaign right now by the biotech industry is to pretend that it isn't and to try and get the European Union to treat it as breeding so that it's not subject to labeling, it's not subject to regulations, that it's just something that can happen and no one will know about it. That's how it is in the United States. There's no body in the United States that regulates gene-edited food. So the FDA doesn't regulate really GMOs. The EPA doesn't regulate it unless it has a plant pest, like a herbicide, etc. And if you send a letter to the USDA and say, I did gene editing for mushrooms and this is true, you don't really need to look at it, do you? And the USDA writes back and says, no, we have no laws that cover it. So don't ask, don't tell, institutionalized, and if we are not careful, then everything will be replaced in an effort to get the money from it. So that's why this is essential that people know this.
So I have a question. I asked it privately about Whole Foods. 5 years ago said they would label GMO, and then you said it's more complicated. It's like, wait a second. Our power is to refuse to eat altered food, GMO food. So if I don't know what that is, how do I do that? So maybe you could, if it's okay to talk about it, because I don't know what you just said about the Whole Foods being too complicated and they broke their promise.
It was too complicated for me to tell you the answer sitting here on the same stage, but I can answer it now. Yeah. So in March of 2013, Whole Foods said that two things. They said when a product becomes non-GMO project verified, there's a spike in sales of 15 to 30%. So immediately, everyone in the natural products industry said, oh, it got to become non-GMO project verified. So that put an 18-month backlog. And that was the tipping point for the natural products industry. At the same time, they said by 2018, you're either going to be certified organic, verified non-GMO, or we're going to pretend, or we're going to consider you as a GMO. We're going to label you as probable GMO if you're not verified non-GMO or certified organic. And that was supposed to be by 2018. They decided not to implement it yet. And their excuse was this.
They mean Whole Foods.
Whole Foods.
Okay.
Whole Foods / Amazon. They decided not to implement it with the excuse that the USDA has a labeling program that they were going to be putting out and going to be presenting, and Whole Foods wanted to see what the USDA program was. Well, the USDA program, as revealed just before Christmas, is a travesty. I can go into it in more detail if there's interest, but it's basically a fake labeling policy. And Whole Foods didn't want to come up with their own labeling requirements that might have been in contradiction with the USDA. So they have that plausible excuse for delaying the labels. But now that the USDA has come out with a terrible, ridiculous, Monsanto-branded labeling law, Whole Foods should say, okay, we saw it, we're rejecting it, we're going to do what's right. Let's hope that they will do that. And you can sign up at responsibletechnology.org. We'll track them, and if they need to hear from all of us, we'll create a letter to them, and you can sign it.
Okay. So are you saying until Whole Foods does that, we stop buying at Whole Foods because we don't know? I'm putting words in your mouth. I'm being a little...
You know, it's interesting. I was.
But you understand the question.
I
right?
do. I do. And I was shopping for baked goods for Christmas, and I went to Santa Cruz Whole Foods, and they didn't have one that was organic. They didn't have any baked goods that were organic, and I went to Safeway, and they had four. So I pulled the manager and said, "Do you know that you have more organic baked goods than Whole Foods? Maybe you should let them know." Here's my My personal preference is to influence people's dietary habits by information on the health dangers rather than on a particular boycott. Because a boycott has a certain amount of shelf life, and it may actually not accomplish what you want because you may not rally the troops to do that. But you should know that when you go to Whole Foods, most of the produce is not organic. And the amount of organic and non-GMO products has declined substantially since Amazon purchased Whole Foods. And they actually wanted to bring in sodas, and they had an internal revolution. And I would say that there's, you know, other, you know what the largest seller of organic is in the United States? Costco. Far more than Whole Foods. And I know I want to give the floor back to my colleagues here, but I would say forget the mystique of Whole Foods and drill down to where can you get healthy food. And if it happens to be Whole Foods that you live next door to, fine. Or it happens to be the farmer's market, or that's even better. Consumer community-supported agriculture, you know, all that's great. Right. You know, growing your own, sprouting, creating indoor garden, outdoor garden. There's a lot of things you can do. But drive it with the principles that you understand about health. And then talk about it so that when you go to Whole Foods and you speak to the produce manager and you say, I notice you don't have any organic blank. I really want organic blank. Do you know where I can get it? Because I'm not going to buy it here. And when you go to restaurants, you say, what do you have that's organic? And just by asking, you'll also educate.
And the point is, if you buy organic, you solve the problem. Because you have to do that research. You have to go to a Safeway, which has more than Whole Foods. And I don't really... positive or negative about Whole Foods, it's like what you just said. If you're going to go organic, then make that your point and educate the people that way. That's really what we're talking about. Get your needs taken, you know, first. Go where you can get organic that you can trust.
Yeah. Speaking broadly for a second, there is a tendency, somebody starts a natural foods brand and they have a lot of ethics and values, and they are a natural foods consumer themselves. The company grows and grows. It establishes a brand of integrity and credibility in the marketplace. And then the founder gets a little tired of running a company with all the stresses of it. And some large corporate food industry entity comes along and says, hey, we'll offer you way more money than you're making right now, and you can be free of all this stress, and we're going to take that beautiful thing you created and take it to the masses and multiply it 10x or 100x and keep all your same values in place. How does that sound? And they sell, and the company or the brand does grow, but then somehow the ethics and integrity get just a bit diluted. Have we seen this before?
Yeah.
So 80% of the natural brands for sale in our natural markets are actually owned by mega corporate food industry entities. Nestle and Coca-Cola and Pepsi and all the rest all have their natural and organic portfolios. So I want to just illustrate for a second, there is a good and a bad to this. Obviously, the bad is that we place our trust as consumers, and we as consumers build brands that then, through our dollars and trust, that then get usurped, and then the profits get absorbed by somebody else, and the quality goes down, and we could see it as selling out, right? On the other hand, natural foods have gone more mainstream. Costco didn't used to sell natural foods. Now they're the largest, you know, retailer of organics in the country. Kroger's as well, Safeway as well. When I was a kid, you couldn't get soy milk in a health food store. Now you have to wade through the soy, the almond, the oat, the pistachio, the cashew, the, you know, hemp, the, all the different options, because there are so many. So we have seen an explosion of accessibility and opportunities and options that have gone mainstream. We now see, you know, natural brands in 7-Elevens even, right? That's because the mothership that owns that brand is one of the giant food corporations. So it cuts both ways. And even with organic, we now have organic ink. We now have large-scale organic in China. And so even if it's USDA organic, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's a mom and pop family out there growing food in the backyard and bringing it to market, you know? Sometimes it's a 20,000-acre facility, and they're doing everything, the minimum, that will meet its USDA certification so they can make that premium price that organic gets. So then the answer, I think, becomes this continuous biodiversity of new solutions popping up. As soon as something gets too big, for those of us who are really passionate and discerning, we find smaller, more beautiful options to take its place. And I think we will probably see a new type of certification, like a regenerative certification that goes beyond organic within the next generation, maybe in the next 5 years.
It's already actually started.
Yeah.
Regenerative organic certification has already started. It's been funded. They're doing beta right now, and maybe by the end of next year, they'll have some certifications.
Yeah. So on the one hand, we recognize, I think, that we want the natural movement to go as mainstream as possible and as broad as possible. And in that sense, mega corporate food entities having skin in the game and having an investment in it keeps them actually interested rather than fighting this movement, right? Because they actually profit from it too. They profit either way, right? But at the same time, we don't want to lose some of the core integrity and be buying from entities that are only interested in profits. We want to feel a sense of trust, I think. I know I, as a consumer, want to invest in the possible world. I don't feel philanthropic if the brand is owned by Nestle, you know? But I do feel philanthropic if it's owned by a low-income community that's working to lift people out of poverty, you know? So I think that we can explore how we keep reinvesting in the possible world we want to create. And the reality is that once you get a new habit in place, it becomes easier to take the next step, and we go further and further so that what once seemed impossible becomes easy because the infrastructure is there in your own life. So wherever you are, whether this stuff is way out there and for you it's like, I don't want to eat French fries anymore, or whether you're in a place where you're trying to figure out how to get the best heirloom kale, and what the best way to wash it is, even if it's organic. You know, we all have places where we're growing, and the question, I think, becomes how do we imbibe and enjoy and absorb where we are and harvest what we've sown and then keep going to the next level.
So the next question is, if two people go out to dinner tomorrow night on Friday night, and they each order fish from the menu, and they drive home, they think they had a nice night, they're nice people, they didn't hurt anyone, they want the environment to be good. What are they not understanding? What just happened? The people, one had their fish from a fish farm, one was caught from the ocean. Seems pretty gentle. Everyone seems to think it's okay. What impact did their fish have on natural resources, the environment, everything?
Well, it's kind of general because there's no universal thing here. But I'll say with fish specifically, let me touch on this. This may be a hot button or a hot topic for some people in the room. I don't know. So the problems with wild fish are, some people may have different perspectives on the health impact, but I'll say from an environmental standpoint, since that's where you're addressing right now, the problem with wild fish is we are massacring the oceans. I mean, we are strip mining them. And the stocks of wild fish are being ravaged. I mean, in many cases, there are 10% of what there were 50 years ago in our oceans. So we're decimating them. And we're polluting our oceans with trash, by the way. And so even some of the fish that are left are eating that trash. They're getting plastic in their bellies and they're starving to death because they can't digest it. And they can't digest other food because their stomachs are filled with plastic. So this is a serious problem, and we do, our oceans are not in good shape. And so just to say that wild fish overfishing is a big issue, and the tuna industry in particular, as sushi has grown more popular, is having major impact, because in order to catch those big fish, they end up catching a lot of smaller fish, the so-called bycatch. And that's thrown away or turned into fish meal for fish farms. And so we're for every one fish that we consider desirable, a lot of other fish are getting caught and killed that we may not consider so desirable. And then fish farms are an environmental disaster because they're, it takes 5 pounds of fish to make 1 pound of fish. Sound familiar? They're feeding them fish from the oceans and some of the bycatch and other stuff. And they're in such close quarters that they have to be given antibiotics to keep them alive because disease would spread rampantly. They are massively polluted. They're swimming in water that's full of fish feces. And so it's very contaminated. And while our farmed salmon has to be have our pink dye put in there to make it that salmon color, because otherwise it would be gray because they're not eating their natural diet. So and farmed fish is very high and even higher, much higher in PCBs and heavy metals and mercury even than the wild fish are. So those are significant environmental concerns. I will say that purely from a health standpoint, I think that there are a very small portion of the fish out there that can be high in omega-3s and low in mercury, and that may, according to a lot of the studies that I've seen, be associated with positive health benefits, although that's often in comparison to maybe people are replacing beef with it, for example. And so you always have to look at what the alternatives and options are. And a great source of omega-3 fatty acids can also be coming from algae if you take a supplement and get your DHA and EPA that way if you don't want to participate in the fish industry.
Well, I appreciate your oceanic view. Little pun, but and it's really good. And again, make it simple. In the Pacific Ocean, all the fish are radioactive at this point. That's a really big issue because the Pacific Ocean is pretty big. So all that's caught. I mentioned from a diabetes prevention point of view, fish fat is specifically toxic to the beta cells of the pancreas that makes insulin. Another little issue. I cut it across in my effort to make it simple for people. Go organic. There's nothing about fish anymore that's organic. They're very high in pesticides, herbicides, and so forth because we've so polluted the oceans that it's not really safe. Period. Wherever you are, and if it's Pacific, I said worse. So that kind of solves the question in a way. It's like, hey, this is not good. Besides the fact of the total destruction that's going on. So the other thing is that, this is a new piece of information, that the fish oil, where the EPA and DHA are, seems to raise the blood sugar. New piece of data, which is like, oh no. So there is available to get your DHA and EPA from the yellow algae, and there's a few companies out. There is actually one here that I have to look at. So it's like, we can get everything we need without eating fish. Done. And that would allow to regenerate, but we have to protect the oceans, or it's still dangerous to eat fish. So we need to put some, you know, deplasticize the oceans and obviously the fish in that way. So that's how we can make it simple. Just stop eating it because it's not good, and that makes people rethink the whole story, and it protects and helps regenerate the whole ocean ecology. That's how I would look at it. It's a simple approach, you know.
So I'm going to bring the biotech perspective in here, and I want to share with you one of the ways that they try and deceive. They'll look at any problem and say, oh, there's a biotech solution, and this is the way. So anything that comes up, whether it's drought or climate change or fish problems, in fact, one of the problems with livestock is that they have to separate the offspring from the mother, and that will make the mother sad, and so they want to genetically engineer out the mothering instinct of livestock. Seriously. Now, with fish, they'll tell you, okay, so you have to, for salmon, for example, it'll take you 3 years or to get to market, and so you have to use all that environmental impact. Use a genetically engineered salmon, and it's outfitted with genes from another salmon and from an Arctic eel, which causes the salmon to produce a growth factor throughout the year, because usually it shuts down during part of the year, but it'll go throughout the year. So in 18 months, it can go to market instead of 3 years. Won't that be good for the environment? Well, the salmon is being sold in Canada. It is being consumed, sold in restaurants and by caterers, unlabeled, not in the United States yet. Now, they did a study in Canada for a related genetically engineered salmon, not the same one from Aqua Bounty, but one that was created in an academic laboratory. And they put this ravenous, imagine growing that fast, you have to eat a lot, right? So these are ravenously hungry salmon. They put them in tanks with just the frankenfish or with the regular salmon as well. And when they put enough food in there, it was no problem. When they reduced the amount of food, the frankenfish freaked. They became cannibalistic and aggressive. They attacked and ate other fish, and they moved into different parts of this tank that was to symbolize or represent what the oceans were like. And what they realized is they created this aggressive gang of mutant fish, and within the tanks, there was either complete extinction or a population crash to just a few left. Now, there are hundreds of thousands of fish that escape fish farms every year. The fences break. And this Aqua Bounty says, oh no, we're gonna grow our fish in tanks inside Panama. And we're gonna grow the eggs in Prince Edward Island in Canada and ship them down. Well, now they're thinking, now that was what they said. Now all of a sudden there's interest around the world in this frankenfish, and it may actually be released sooner than later into these ocean fenced in areas. Now imagine if they have the quality of this Canadian experiment, and they grow faster also, so the mating, the females, for example, may have a preference for the bigger frankenfish than the natural. So they may have a survival advantage, and they may wipe out natural salmon as a result, and they may, in the reduction of ocean fish, their hunger may be unsatiated, and they may become the roving gang members of the ocean created in laboratories in the United States and in Canada. So this is and if you eat it, the number of fish that were used to test the safety was so small that a 25% increase or a 50% increase in things that were pretty serious, like allergic reactions or a cancer-related hormone, were considered statistically insignificant. And rather than sending it back and saying, hey, before you feed this to millions of people, do a real study, they didn't. So you may end up, it may create cancer, and there's plenty of evidence that it could, and it may create additional allergic reactions. So I would say stay away from the genetically engineered solutions to all problems.
I think the thing you said, just a comment, is you eat it in Canada, you don't know if it's GMO engineered or not. So that brings us again saying, we're not gonna eat your food because we can't trust it. Changes the story. Yeah. It's a very, very important little principle. Just go organic. If you can't get organic, forget it. That will change the whole, what we get, because we do have power.
One other note of caution for wild salmon eaters. A study recently found that 60%+ of the salmon sold in restaurants, including many upscale restaurants, that was sold as wild was actually farmed. There's no regulation on this point. You just take the restaurant's word for it, and obviously it attracts a premium price. And we may soon recognize that farmed could also mean genetically engineered if that comes onto the marketplace here, although it hasn't yet. I don't know that that's the case for salmon that's sold like in stores, but that is the case in restaurants.
So I have a question on the statistic, Ocean.
Yeah.
Is it 60% of all salmon, including those that were sold as wild, or is it 60% of the wild
salmon? Of the wild. This isn't a super comprehensive study. Yeah. This was, they tested like 10 restaurants.
60%.
Nationwide. Like
60% of those that claimed to be wild turned out to be
That's right.
domestic.
That's right. Farmed.
Farmed.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Shocking.
So,
well, again, the principle holds. If you can't trust it, don't buy it. And there'll have to be a level of integrity. Keep it simple.
So if someone heard this lecture and they said, wow, I heard what Ocean said about fish. I'm not going to eat that because of the problems with fish. And I certainly don't want to eat the factory farm chicken or pork or beef. But maybe I'll just have a simple boiled egg. So what is the impact on having a nice, you know, friendly boiled egg on the environment?
Stephen, do you have an agenda here?
I'll at the risk of being unpopular with the vegan world, I don't have an ethical problem with a neighbor who has chickens in the backyard, and those chickens are clucking around and living a good life, and they're protected from coyotes in something, and they poop on the soil, and they're even made into a little chicken tractor to help stir up the ground, and their eggs are eaten by humans. I don't have an ethical problem with that. And we have a neighbor who does just that, and they gave us eggs, and we ate them, and that started me feeling comfortable with pasture-raised eggs in moderation. I don't think they're some health savior, but I don't have an ethical problem with it personally. So that's just to put that out there. And, you know, conventional eggs are raised in a brutal, horrific conditions. Even free-range certification means the birds had 2 or 3 square feet per bird, which is not good in my book. Pasture-raised means 108 square feet. That's really, really different. That means they actually ran around outside and had room to roam. And so personally, those are the only eggs I ever consume, but I do include them in my ecosystem of food, and I feel comfortable with that. And from a health standpoint, that isn't to say there's a lot of controversy here. I'm not necessarily advocating that they are something you should eat for a healthy diet. I am just saying that I don't have an ethical problem or an ecological problem with it. So that might not be the answer you were looking for, but that's where I am with it.
Yeah. First of all, I never liked eggs. So besides, you know, that being said, and I'm just joking, but actually, I never did like eggs. It actually, in terms of diabetes, as I mentioned this morning, one egg a week is going to increase your rate of getting diabetes by 76%. If you do an egg a day, you're increasing your rate of getting diabetes by 300%. That's one level of issue. Because, you know, that's about diabetes. Now, in terms of blood type, it turns out for like a whole lecture to explain it, but basically eggs create a problem with every blood type. It cuts across the whole blood type thing. So it creates a kind of sensitivity and an inflammation. So that's, again, a thing that a lot of people are aware of. But the major blood types are all more sensitive to eggs. So it's not good for your health that way as well. So I'm just kind of mentioning two little things about eggs that we can consider. There is an issue of, again, I think it's more commercially grown eggs, but a certain kind of cancer that's passed on with eggs, commercially grown eggs. I won't go into details of it, but so there are some issues. Salmonella is another thing that's passed on the eggs. So there are problems with the commercially grown eggs, different than a locally grown egg, hopefully. Okay, so there are just a few things to consider in the picture in terms of a health issue. So I'll just raise it that way about the egg issue.
Thank you, and I would like to say that I hope and doubt that the research that was done on the eggs that you quoted was done on organic, pasture-raised chicken eggs. Because I have learned that the quality of the egg and the reactivity of the egg eater is a lot dependent on what the chicken eats. I heard a story from a farmer whose friends had the following experience. They had their own chickens, and they ordered non-GMO feed, and they ate eggs every morning. And one morning, after eating eggs, the wife and the daughter had an anaphylactic allergic reaction and were rushed to the hospital. The father called the chicken feed dealer and said, "Has there been any change?" And he said, "Yes, I could not get the non-GMO feed, so I just delivered just before then, the GMO feed," and didn't mention that to him. Now, this is an anecdotal story. It's a story of someone that may not be representative of a significant amount of the population. But from my interviews with people, there are many people who react to milk, meat, or eggs that have been fed GMOs versus not. And so when you ask the question about eating a boiled egg, well, there's the factory farm, if it's that would disqualify it for a lot of reasons. But unless it's organic or non-GMO verified, then it might be fed GMOs. Now, the FDA scientists were asked years ago to input on a GMO policy. And we now have their documents. There's some on our responsibletechnology.org website. Gerald Guest, who was the head of the Department of Veterinary Medicine for the FDA, said that there are unique health risks for those eating milk and meat, and I think also eggs, of animals that have been fed GMOs. It's certainly possible that things can bioaccumulate. Toxins eaten and chewed in the food may be stored in the fat, and actually the amount of toxins in the fat may be more than the animals eating per bite because now they've accumulated. We know that the milk from animals fed Roundup Ready soy is different in its structure than the milk from animals from cows that eat regular soy. So this is why milk, meat, and eggs, the animal products, if you choose to eat it, if it's organic, it's been fed organic feed. If it's non-GMO verified, it's been fed non-GMO feed. And so there's also wild caught, we have those problems. These are ways to avoid the GMO fed. But even if you catch some fish in parks, in lakes, they may have been raised and fed genetically engineered soy pellets as part of their breeding process before they're released. So that's my input on the egg.
Yeah, I think that the issue is there are a lot of unknowns. My thing is a very old teaching from Maimonides, a great medieval physician, 12th century. If there's a question, don't eat it. Real simple stuff. There's a question, don't eat it. So it's a very important health principle. And there is a question. That's the key. That's all we can really say when we're talking about it. It's like, if there's a question, don't eat it. I mean, how hard is that? And if we take it that way, it's really good guy. We live in a very complicated world, but you know, if you buy local, organic, and you've inspected the person, you trust the person, you don't have much question. If you're growing your own, you don't really have a lot of question. So those are kind of simple ways to go about sorting this out. That's really takes us, cuts through a lot of detail for us.
If you could get beef, chicken, or pork raised in the most pristine, grass-fed New Zealand land where they're outdoors and they have the best everything, how does that impact the environment? If someone's buying super organic, grass-fed, organic pork and chicken, what's the environmental impact?
That is a very controversial question. And a super organic and grass-fed doesn't necessarily tell us everything we might need to know about the environmental impact, because rainforest beef could be organic and grass-fed and destroying the planet. But I also know farmers who are using livestock in an integrated way as a part of their organic farms, and the manure is a critical part of the health of the soil, the way that they're replenishing it. Now, you can do a veganic agriculture, and we could investigate that more, but currently, most of our organic farms are using manure in a significant way. So I think that the reality of it is that I in my vision of an ideal world, just like there were buffalo here hundreds of years ago, I think that livestock in some form play a part in a wholesome, balanced ecosystem, but there are a lot less of them than we have now. As was quoted in that article, 86% of the mammals on the land of the world now are humans and livestock combined. So we are just taking over, right? And we need a lot more wild creatures and wild spaces and wild things to truly be sustainable and in right relation with the planet around us. So, but I know some people who feel that they do better with a certain amount of pasture-raised animal products in their diet. That's not me, but I respect everyone. I think that everyone's own right to discover what works for them. The average American gets 34% of their calories from animal products. The blue zones where people live the longest, healthiest lives are 0 to 10%. So I'm more interested in getting from 34 down to 10 or less than I am in whether 0 or 1 or 2 or 5 or 10 is optimal. And I'm much more interested in getting rid of the factory farming system than I am in determining whether pasture-raised has any place anywhere. And for the moment, I allow people to create what works for them in my mind and my vision of the world I want to create, and also recognize that there are some really clear directions we need to move radically and fast.
Okay. The EPA has basically said that 95 to about 97% of the pesticides and herbicides are found in animal tissue, because it's higher on the food chain. That's a pretty important thing. And I'm talking about organically grown as well. It doesn't really matter because there's so much pollution going on. If you, for a child, for example, if you go organic, doesn't mean they're going to be free from it. They're just going to have 1/4 to 1/6 the amount of pesticides in their blood as if you're eating junk inorganic food. You're not free from it. Same thing with organic food. What they found is you had 1/4 the amount of pesticides and herbicides. You're not free from it, even with organically grown food. I'm talking about vegetables, but you're lower on the food chain. So it isn't exactly a perfect world. So I think it's important that, that we understand that, because perfectionism really can be really hard on the mind. So it's never going to be quite perfect. Eating lower on the food chain is important. Now, I'll give you an example of why that's important. Right now, the sperm count around the world is, viable sperm count, is at about 50%. It just has to drop a little bit more before we move into infertility. You kind of hinted at it before about how do we get people to be fertile. Well, get away from the GMO. But I'm saying the sperm count. And that has to do with pesticides. Really, a lot has to do with pesticides, herbicides, and so forth. So it may be that the vegans are going to repopulate the world because they're eating lower in the food chain. Just think about that, okay? We have to have a sense of humor about it, or we get a little depressed. Okay. So, but think about this huge evidence of that, and fertility rates for women have dramatically gone down. When you look at the statistics, they've dramatically decreased. So fertility is going down. Well, if everybody becomes infertile, that's it for human existence. So we have to kind of look at it in a big way. So eating higher in the food chain is going to expose you to 95 to 96% of it. Breastfed milk, okay. Women who are just vegetarian, okay, have 1% of the pesticides and herbicides in their breast milk as meat-eating women. That's huge because of lots of reasons, neurological development of the baby and so forth. So really the concept to make it easy, eat lower on the food chain. Protect yourself. Protect, for men, protect your sperm. No small deal. And for women, protect your ability to have children. No small deal. So we are really talking, when we're actually talking about this, is the existence of humanity and protecting humanity by eating lower in the food chain. So that's another framework of how to look at this. It's like, oh, hey, if we're infertile, we have a problem. Okay? So I'm going to throw that in as a consideration for the evolution of the species, is we've got to eat lower in the food chain. This morning I gave the example of even 3% when they did a Buddhist study of vegans and women who are eating meat, vegan Buddhist monks who are eating meat once, like 3% of their intake was meat, they had 4 times less diabetes. 3%, 4 times less. That's what we're talking about. And men who are about 8%, because that's what the meat-eating men, Buddhist monks were eating, you know, they had half the amount of diabetes. They had twice the amount of diabetes. So what we're talking about is a little bit makes a big difference on a lot of levels. So that's how I tend to look at it, broad strokes. You have a question, don't eat it. Maimonides, the greatest physician of the 12th century. It's not that complicated. We need to make it less complicated in how we're looking at it.
Okay. I talk about some of the fertility issues in my lectures, and I, at one point in my slideshow, I have a picture of rat testicles. And on the left are pink rat testicles. On the right are purple or bluish rat testicles. And I say, and the ones on the left were the control group that ate the regular soy, and the ones that had changed color ate the GMO soy. And I describe what happened, and then I say, I use this slide to take an opportunity for a long, slow drink of water. And I'm drinking the water slowly as all the guys are looking at these rat testicles. It has an effect. It's good to know that the organs are affected. And I also want to mention that, since you mentioned infertility, in the film Secret Ingredients, the chiropractic clinic that had 92 infertile couples that have children, the number of couples that were infertile that did their protocol that didn't have children was 0. So 100%. So I like being third because by the time it gets to me, you've already forgotten the question. And I get to talk about whatever I want because that's my question. My answers may have to be like, I'm a GMO guy. But I will say this, since we were at one point
talking. Non-GMO guy.
Non-GMO guy. Thank you. Thank you. We were talking about livestock, and there's plenty of evidence that farmers, when they put animals on a non-GMO diet, they get better, and the livestock producers make more money because they're spending less in medicines, less in antibiotics, and the pig, in the case of pigs, conception rates higher, and litter size can be higher, and we've seen severe stomach inflammations in pigs, et cetera. I mean, just tremendous evidence from actual farms that have made the switch. But whenever I interview a farmer who's made the switch, they always use this one very technical word, and they don't hear it from others. They just come up with it spontaneously themselves about what they've noticed in their pigs or cows. And they say to me, the animals are happier. And you can see it in their eyes. And sometimes the farmers start to tear up because they can see the change in their animal when they switch them to non-GMO feed. They can sometimes the social animals of cows become individual and irritated and aggravated on a GMO compared to... Anyway, I just thought I'd share that little one piece that very few people know about impacts on feed.
So I'm going to ask you one final closing question, but I do want to say a lot of times people will come up to me and go, what's your incentive for having the Real Truth About Health conference? Like, why are you doing this? It's a 10-day conference. It seems like a whole big deal. It's tough to sell advertising. Like, why are you doing this? What's your main incentive? Are you making a lot of money? And they say, no, we're trying to cover our costs, and so far we haven't. So what's the incentive? And I think the incentive is that every now and then I hear something that sends chills through my body. And when Gabriel Cousens says the sperm count is down 50%, I'm not going to go into more detail what that means. In other words, it's chilling. It's not like I didn't hear like something light. I mean, maybe I misinterpreted, but to me, if it went down 50% since the 1970s, and if we keep doing everything, it goes down and then can reproduce, that to me is a science fiction nightmare movie. And that's the type of thing that makes me think, man, I don't know what to do, but maybe we should have a big conference and try to tell people, and maybe someone will tell someone will tell someone, and somehow we'll do something. But it's one of those pieces of information, you know, and then you could add in what Jeffrey said about the genetic editing, and these things seem chilling, science fiction, nightmarish, that I feel like somebody, let's have a big conference, let's tell a lot of people, and then I'm hoping someone out there knows someone or has a big list or a website or is going to take action. But this stuff is really meaningful information that I hope someone young or old is making their quest to do something. I'm trying my best, they're trying their best, but in the end, I'm sure hoping that everyone understands that this is meant for everyone to do the best they can with the information. So my final question, though, is should we as a society completely get rid of chemicals and fertilizers, insecticides, pesticides? And if we did, is that a great solution, or is that a silly solution because we couldn't grow enough food? And along with that, any other closing comments you want to make?
There are 1,400 chemicals routinely used in the U.S. food supply, additives, preservatives, flavorings, colorings, emulsifiers, etc. Most of them have never been tested for their long-term impact on human beings. I think that should stop. There are neurotoxic pesticides being sprayed on our crops that were developed during World War II to kill people. I think we shouldn't be putting that on our food. When we see farm workers dying of cancer in droves, I think that's reason enough to say that we probably shouldn't be eating the food that they are exposed to in the fields either. So yes, in general, but would I ban all chemicals everywhere under every circumstance? Probably not. I think that there exists the possibility that science can serve humanity, but here's what I would do. I would like to take the choice about what's permissible and what's not out of the hands of companies who stand to profit from the exploitation of technologies. So I think that technologies and the use of them, whenever we're messing with Mother Nature, need to be vetted seriously by people whose job is to look out for public well-being. Period. And we need to have a lot more respect for the extraordinary, magnificent, miraculous, wondrous brilliance of the design of life itself. Because it is absolutely incredible how, in the food world, we keep learning about how compounds interact with each other in ways that we couldn't even imagine before. The whole is so much greater than the sum of its parts. And it's magnificent. And our bodies know what to do with real food, because that's what they were designed for. So let's feel appropriate humility and awe, and let's use these bright minds of ours to understand how nature works first before we try to improve on it.
Very nice. I raised the question, based on the science that's really out there, specifically with your question, whether pesticides and herbicides are actually making things better, or are they making things worse? Are they making things more productive or less productive? And I think the data is tending to suggest that organic actually makes things more equal to or 10% more productive. Partly we got all these pesticide-resistant plant weeds and all these things. So in the long run, we actually get more health mileage, higher quality food, and equal to or better production by going organic. So I don't really have a problem letting go of all these pesticides and herbicides. The average baby in its umbilical blood has about 290 pesticides and herbicides and so forth. And at 190, you know, you're very susceptible to high rates of cancer and disease. So we're just way out there in terms of what is the exposure. And again, as I said, even if you're eating organic, you're still going to have 1/4 to 1/6 amount of pesticides and herbicides. So if we actually eliminate it in a generation or two, we can actually start restoring sperm count, start restoring health, stop decreasing cancer and heart disease and diabetes. These are all things that are directly related to the pesticide herbicide exposure, plus pretty much all the chronic diseases. So it wouldn't be much of a loss, particularly if we get 10% more productivity. That's kind of cool. Now, we know some agricultural approaches, effective microorganisms that you can put in the soil that actually eat up all the pesticides and herbicides. So we can actually, within a year — it used to take 5 years to go organic — within a year we can return the soil back to organic. And we use this in different places, so which we also use at the Tree of Life. So effective microorganisms, we can turn this thing around really quickly. So it would be no loss, it would be a huge gain if we did this. Mm. So again, with the idea that it's simple, which is what you're implying too, let's go back to the natural ways. And it really works better. It's clearly healthier. And we aren't the ones to improve on God's plan. We don't need to even be that egoic to think better living through technology. No, worse living, more dangerous living. And so the natural ways have been here forever. And when we honor it and return to it, we are going to see more health, more evolution of humanity, also emotionally, mentally, and spiritually, because all these things do disorganize our thinking processes. That's a fact. I will just mention one experiment was done in Wisconsin where they just served organic food. I'm not even talking about meat. And, you know, they served organic food at lunch. And this is in Appleton, Wisconsin, and over a six-year period, and academic scores went up and athletic performance went up. All you did was go organic. I mean, how hard is that? So the data is there. Can we return to the natural ways and honor the divine plan that has been given to us? So that's what I am suggesting as we discuss these kind of issues, which you do have an agenda, which is a good agenda. Gets us to talk about things, which is good. So that's a consideration. Let's keep it really simple, going back to the natural and divine ways.
When I travel around the world, the local hosts always love to bring me to farms and to bring me to the farms that are using sustainable and organic and agroecological methods. So I've seen them all over the world. And Vandana Shiva will be here tomorrow. I've been to her farm. They don't need any chemicals there. It's the biodiversity and the richness of the soil which protects it. So I've seen how farming can be without the synthetic chemicals. And even park care and lawn care. We have a website called RoundupRisks.com. And we have a program to help people stop the spraying of Roundup and other toxic herbicides in their areas, in the parks, in the golf courses, the homeowners association, by the cities, by the counties. And in there, I interview three women who were successful at changing policies locally and how they did it. And we have some of the resources that they used. And I was interviewing Kathleen Halal, who got Irvine, the city of Irvine, to switch. And when the city switched, then all of a sudden schools were switching and homeowners associations were switching. It was a big domino effect. And we later were walking through the halls of the state assembly in Sacramento in California to speak to the representatives. And by that time, she said to me, guess what? In Irvine, they're spending less money per year than when they used Roundup, and the fields are more beautiful, because they used the natural soil and the natural methods. And it was quick. It was like 1 year into saving money. So there are tremendous opportunities out there that are not being promoted because the money is not in the type of agriculture that doesn't pay out to the big agribusiness. And so the research is not there. The media is not there. The agricultural extension agents from the land-grant universities have a different, they have a chemical focus. So it's structurally built into the system. And even the application of the insecticides are based on creating plants that are sick, that attract the insects that can digest the sick plant's protein structure or amino acid structure. And if the plants were healthy, the insects could not extract the kind of nutrients from it that they can from the sick plants. So they create, the agribusiness creates the partially sick, partially diseased agricultural structure that is forced to use the inputs. And we're all suffering from that. So yeah, I think that we could probably eliminate most or all of the chemical agents intelligently by demonstrating effective alternatives. And you asked if we could end whatever we want. I want to say this. I'm an activist, so I love getting people active. And some of you have been listening to many lectures, and you get different, you're taking notes, some of you and whatnot. I'd like to recommend one thing that I've learned, and that is to make a choice based on information that's inspiring, make the choice immediately. So by the time you listen to five more days of this or five more lectures, what we said is gone. So if you're taking notes, take the last page and write down, do this on the top. And anytime you think of something that you needed to do, go to the back page and write that down. And that's what you gotta take away from your notebook and put on your refrigerator. But even more so, do something immediately, like tonight. Like immediately after watching this, what action would you like to take? What information would you like to learn? Who would you like to share this with? Something. And you know what that is. No one else can tell you. But rather than say, oh yeah, I'll do it later, we all know the trap of I'll do that later. So many things get between us and that becomes never. So my suggestion, my going away instructions and recommendation is, what do you want to do tonight to say yes to it so that your life will be enriched by what you've heard? And then every time you hear another speaker, same thing. What action, what step, what information you need, something, so that you are actively allowing knowledge to have organizing power in your life.
Thank you to Ocean Robbins, Gabriel Cousens, and Jeffrey Smith.
So I actually want to thank Ocean and Jeffrey and you, Stephen, for making such a great panel. It's really great.
Thank you.
Really enjoyed it.
And I want to thank you for giving the most precious resource any of us have, which is your attention. It is so precious. And so thank you for listening and for participating. You know, Jeffrey's call to action is so well-timed, I think. And I want to appreciate you in advance for every way you will implement everything you have learned today in your life in ways that uplift all of us. Thank you so much. Uh-huh.